Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
I thought today we could continue in on that subject, continue in on that theme of looking at things that trip us up, things that keep us or hold us back in life. And I had a really fun experience last week, if you were here. He showed some funny pictures of people who got stuck. I mean, I don't know if you remember, there was a guy in a McDonald's high chair. You remember that? And the police and the fire department were there. I mean, how embarrassing is that? And, you know, I was thinking, I was out, you know, I like to do anything outside. I mean, I love anything that has to do with outdoors, hiking, biking, climbing, walking, exploring, driving, anything like that. And I like to explore. And so on Tuesday this last week, my wife and I, we had the day together and we decided, let's get the kids, let's throw them in the truck. Let's get the dogs. Let's throw them in the truck. We'll get some blankets and some picnic stuff and a pack of cooler. And let's go out there to Big Bear and let's go explore our mountains. And I brought my brother-in-law along who spent all the time up there hunting and cutting firewood and just all sorts of manly, burly things. He's up there all the time. And so we were up there and we were going to go check out these pinnacles in Big Bear. And so we're driving out there on the dirt road. And my wife was driving, actually, because she gets car sick, and on those mountain roads, we just said, you know what, you drive, and it's just a Forest Service road, and, you know, a long time ago, I had a Jetta. I was unaware, sorry if you're a man and you have a Jetta, I apologize, I was unaware that a Jetta is a girl's car. I didn't know that until I bought my Jetta, and like, every male that I knew from that point forward was like, you know that's a girl's car, right? And it was like, totally didn't know that. And so the day that came when I sold my Jetta to buy my 4x4 off-road truck was like the best day of my life, because all of a sudden, like, the buyer's remorse was gone. And if you've ever seen my truck in the parking lot, it's always dirty. I just try to do my part with the drought, you know, and conserve water. People always tell me, says, man, you really like to take that thing off-roading. And I say, well, you know, I mean, yes and no. If you look at off-roading in the sense of my opinion of it at the present, off-roading, I would account that as to a road that's not paved, sure, great. You know, like, I like to do the fishing and hiking, and sometimes you got to drive on dirt roads, and what happens, you know, be that as it may, there's dirt on those roads. So we're driving on a dirt road. My wife's driving, and we're going to this place in Big Bear, and we realized that we were just kind of talking, just enjoying the scenery. We're up in Big Bear. There's all sorts of different gold mining history and little placards, and we were just talking about the history of Big Bear. It was really kind of fun. And we realized that we had missed the turn of the road, because they're all just, the roads up there, when they're the forest roads, they're just numbers. And they don't, you know, they don't have names. It's just like 1N09 is the number, and then 1N16 or whatever the number of the road is. That's all it is. And so we realized that we had missed the turn on the road. My brother says, oh, you know, I've been up here. I've literally spent, like, I don't know, we told us, like, 4 or 5 months if you took all the time that I've been up in Big Bear driving and hiking and whatever it is. You know, he's like, I know all of these roads. So he's like this human road map. He says, I know the shortcut. If you've ever heard me tell stories of hiking and getting lost in the mountains, and biking and getting lost in the mountains, or fishing and getting lost in the mountains, you might know that this is the same brother-in-law, my wife's brother. We should have known. I know a shortcut to where we're going, and we said, you know, like, hey man, you know, I've been with him. He has like the real off-road kind of car. You know what I'm talking about? When I say real off-road, like, one time I went, and he knew a shortcut one time, and he told me about it. I know a shortcut. And it wasn't a road. It was just the mountain. Like, it was just rocks, and there was, like, mufflers and things on the side of the roads. And I'm like, this isn't a road, dude. And he's like, yeah, man, it's cool. I got it. So I told him, like, hey, listen, man. Like, this isn't one of your shortcuts. No, no, no. To quote my brother, sorry if this offends you, he says, this is the road wussies take to go four-by-ing. I'm like, that's the road I want to be on. So we're driving on this road on this shortcut, and sure enough, oh, I forgot, he says, there's this one section that's a little bit technical, but your truck, no problem, you'll handle it. And so there we're driving, and Stacy's like, I'm not driving anymore, so I have to get in, and we're driving, and it gets so technical that he has to get out of the truck to spot me, all right? When it gets that bad, it's not a road anymore, right? And so we come up to this one spot, and there's a rock. I have a picture of it. I'll just show you the rock. Okay, yeah, that's a road. All right? Apparently, that's the Wussy Road, as a matter of fact. So that's a rock the size of a Volkswagen. That's my brother holding his McDonald's coffee. making sure that I can get over that, and I am sweating bullets in my truck. It's stock, totally, you know, I mean, it's kind of built for that, but not really. And so he says, no problem, you got it. And he's out there and he's directing me and he says, okay, I just want you to drive it slowly. Put your tire here, put your tire there. So I proceed to follow his instructions. And so the next picture is me driving on the rock. You can see, I mean, that's like a manly picture. I'm like, that's my truck. Yeah, that's right. You know, that's it. That's my baby. You know, a little bit of dirt. It looks good. And I was really excited. I made it over the rock. And then what happened is, once my tire got over that rock, gravity took effect. And the very next picture is the perplexed look of my brother and my sad face as my truck high-centered on that rock. And luckily, because I have an off-road version of the Tacoma of my truck, it has armor and it has cross members to stop you from like crushing the necessities, but I was sitting on my muffler. And literally, I had my truck in four-wheel drive, and I'm trying to go, and I can feel it, and you just hear it grinding, like, and nothing's going, and he's like, oh, wow, I thought you could have got that. I've been with him before. I've been stuck. We were stuck for a couple of hours once, actually more than once, on shortcuts that he knew of. You would think I would know. And, you know, I was thinking about Pastor Joel's message, how to not get stuck. Don't listen to your brother-in-law when he says he knows a shortcut. Well, after a little while of examining and, you know, we didn't have any tow straps, we didn't have any kind of come along, I don't have a winch or anything to get my truck off, we had to get some creative thinking. I had to use my little stock jack that you kind of like, you know, crank up and it takes a gajillion turns to make it move, and had to put rocks underneath, like jack my truck up and then put rocks underneath and then move the jack and then put the jack on top of the rocks and jack it up again and keep doing that. But finally we made it through, you know, with minimal damage, a little bit, minimal, but it's okay. And we got stuck. You know, I was thinking about it, man, there's just so much in life that trips us up. Literally. rocks in Big Bear, and so, but as I was thinking about that, I thought, you know, how much fun is that, or how effective is that to talk about things that get us stuck? And last week, we talked about two things in our lives that can get us stuck, where we literally, like my car, are stuck, no matter if I try to go forward, or if I try to backpedal, no matter what I did, I could not get off the rock. I needed assistance. There are things in life that get us stuck. Last week we talked about two. Pastor Joel brought up two amazing things. One was our judgments, and just our judgments of other people, and what we say really can come back onto us. And he told some great stories about judging. And the second one was the confessions, or what we speak. You know, our words have so much power, and we can speak things into our life that literally halts progress in our life. And as I was thinking about this over the course of the week, I thought, you know, there's some amazing things in life that we can look at, and they're so simple but so impactful, of things that get us stuck. They're things that we live with every day, things that we deal with on a daily basis, from literally the moment we're old enough to have a personality to understand, all the way through the course of our life till the day we die. These are things that we deal with. And I just want to talk to you about two things. I'll just tell you right ahead what they are. The two things that can get us stuck, and what we can do to understand them and to get beyond them, is offense and bitterness. Oh man, I tell you, if there's something that can trip you up in life, it's offense. Literally, offense is the tripping hazard of life. You see, life moves forward. No matter if you move forward or not, life continually goes on. You heard the phrase, life goes on. And I remember one time, just to kind of think about that, I remember one time before we had kids, my wife and I, we were up in the mountains and we were mountain biking. I didn't even tell her about this. I was going to tell the story of her. And we were mountain biking with our web designer, Michael Espinoza. And we were on the Santa Ana River Trail, and we had just started, and I was in front, Michael was behind me, and Stacy was right behind me. We were mountain biking. And we went through this little technical spot, and my wife, she didn't quite, you know, she wasn't really advanced in biking at the time. And so what happened is she kind of hit these rocky parts, and when you do that, you got to get your bum off the seat. You can't have your butt on the seat of a bike when you're going through the bouncy parts, because it literally becomes like a bucking bronco. And what happened is she was going through these bouncy parts, and it literally bucked her off the bike, and she went over the handlebars into a bunch of pine cones, into a bunch of pine needles. But you see, I was thinking about that. Life moves on. I was in front of her. I kept going. Michael was in front of her. He kept going because we didn't know that she fell. And then all of a sudden we stopped when we got through the technical part of the trail and we're like, where's Stacy? So we had to turn around and go, and there she's on the ground, and we picked her up and dusted her off, and she says, I am never mountain biking again. And I think that was like true to form, never again she went. But it's just like that in life. You know, you can hit a tripping hazard of a fence, and life keeps going. Everybody around you keeps progressing forward. Life keeps pushing on. Your family, your friends, the people that you work with, their lives keep progressing while you have stumbled and fallen on your face. And then we wonder, why is nobody around me? What happened? Why doesn't anybody notice? We're wondering what's going on. And it's because we have literally been tripped in life, in the progress of life, by this thing we call offense. And to offend or to have an offense is simply to do something that is wrong to somebody else. Or to have something, to be offended is to have somebody wrong you. And there's just some things I think that if we can understand, if we can look at, if we can apply biblical truths to our lives, then we can look at these hazards and we can say, you know what? I'm not going to get stuck in life. Because God's desire for us is to move forward. God's desire for you is forward progress. And you know, ultimately what happens in life, we all trip and fall. But we don't have to stay down. We can get up. Like my truck that was stuck on the rock, it set us back. The plans had to change for the day because it was a longer road than we thought. But ultimately, we got through it. And you can get through it as well. And today, I want to just look at some things about this, and then we'll look at the other one, bitterness, and just what the Bible says about that. And here, I think that there's some amazing truths, and we'll look at some section of scriptures, and I'll quote some other ones. And so we'll have a lot of scriptures today, but that's okay. They'll be up on the screens for you, and you can just take notes if you want. But some very important things for you and I to understand. And Jesus has an amazing statement in the book of Matthew, and he says this. He says, go ahead and put up Matthew. He says, woe to the world because of offenses. Woe to the world because of offenses. For offenses must come. But woe to the man by whom the offense comes. And Jesus is talking to the people here, and he's talking to his followers, and he's actually talking about children, and he goes on, he says, man, if anybody of you has anything that holds them back, man, you don't want that on your life. But I thought it was really interesting how he says this. He says, woe to the world because of offenses. The world is a messed up place because of offense. And he says this because not that offenses may come, that you might be offended in life. He says, for offenses must come. You know, I think what we can realize and things that can help us to not get tripped up on offenses is to realize and recognize in our lives that no matter where we're at, no matter what stage of life we're in, that we will, listen, you will be offended. I heard some amens, praise God. But it's like, man, I don't want to hear that. Nobody wants somebody to tell them, hey, you're going to get offended in your life. Nobody, man, I found Jesus. I thought all that stuff's going to be over. The truth is, we're all human. And at some point in our life, somebody's going to say something. Somebody's going to do something. You're probably already there before. Somebody's already said something to you. Somebody's already done something. Pastor Luke, you don't even have a clue or a half of what's happened to me and how offended I am at this person or what they've done to me. The truth of the matter is, out of the words of Jesus Christ, we will in our lives be offended. But you see, there's some things that we can understand because he says, woe to the world because offenses must come. But when we realize and when we recognize in life that this is an imperfect world, listen, this is a world, oh, it's so frustrating. This is a world that promotes tolerance. The message of tolerance is more so today than it has ever been in society ever. But do you know that we live in a less tolerant world now than we ever have? We're only tolerant of somebody who thinks our ideals. And literally because of this, we're ripping each other apart. The Democrats versus the Republicans, the conservative versus the liberal Christian, the gay rights versus the conservative Christian, whatever it might be. The rich and the poor. You see, we say, let's tolerate, let's be open-minded, let's live in a world of peace, but we refuse to live in a world of peace when somebody doesn't live or speak or act or do according to what I think is right. And that offends me. And so we tear each other apart. But you know, the truth is that Jesus tells us offenses will come. You will be offended. Heck, if give it any amount of time, and I'm sure that myself or Pastor Dan or for sure Pastor Jim will offend you from the pulpit. They're gonna come. But you know, Jesus told his disciples over and over and over and over and over again, you'll face tribulation. People will hate you. They'll persecute you. They'll drag you out of your homes. You're gonna be offended. You're gonna have hard times. They're gonna hate you because he prepared them. And you realize that when you read the book of Acts and you see the things of Peter and John preaching in Solomon's portico, and they were persecuted. Paul locked up in the prisons because of the warnings, because of the teachings, because of Jesus Christ telling them over and over and over again, hey, you're going to get offended. You're going to be offended. They weren't blindsided by it when it came. When we prepare our hearts, when we prepare our lives to say, you know what? I'm probably going to get offended. I'm probably going to interact with somebody in church, heaven forbid, that's going to say something or do something or look at me or act a certain way that offends me. But when we begin to prepare our hearts and say, you know what, offenses are going to come in my life, then we allow ourselves to prepare to handle those offenses. I mean, think about it, like when Paul Paul was locked up in the prison and the earthquake came. He didn't go slap the prison guard afterwards. You offended me. You beat me. He was prepared because his heart was ready because he knew that a life following Jesus would be a life full of offenses. People are going to say things to you. People are going to do things to you that hurts you, that offends you, that rubs you the wrong way. Listen, the gospel is an offense, the Bible says. Jesus Christ in the book of Isaiah is the stumbling block in which the religious cannot get over. But yet we had to learn in our flesh to get over that, which means we are capable and able to get over offenses when they come our way. Because God's desire is that when they come, they don't trip us and stop us. So he says offenses may come. But on the other side of the coin, he says, woe to him who brings an offense. Hey, let's get off our soapbox for a moment, church. We're all people. We're all human. We say things. We say dumb things. Just a couple of weeks ago, she's not back there today, which is good, but one of our wonderful sound technicians, I was goofing off with everybody, and I was messing around, and I said something that hurt her feelings. I was just joking, but I was like, man, Pastor Luke, foot in mouth, like so good. I am human. You see, I'm going to say something that's going to offend somebody. You are going to say something and do something that's going to offend somebody else. But what we have got to do is prepare and to watch ourselves so that we don't offend anybody, that we don't speak out when we shouldn't speak out. You know, we live in a society that promotes freedom of speech because our Constitution gives us the right to say what we want. We equate that to our lives to say, I can say whatever I want without consequence. But there's a difference between freedom of speech, hello, and wisdom. I grew up, my mama, I guess I'm old school, but my mama taught me, everybody has a right to an opinion, but not everybody has a right to voice it. And sometimes the best thing to do is just to not say anything at all. I'm shocked, and I'm guilty of it myself. But I just can't believe on the things that people, especially Christians, us, you and I, hey, I'm guilty of what we post on the internet, on Facebook or on Instagram or on Twitter or social media, whatever it might be, thinking, oh man, this is okay. When somebody looks at us and says, you're a Christian, and you say those, you do those, what are you doing? We not only have to stop playing the victims, we got to watch ourselves. Because offenses will trip us up, but guess what? We will also do things that can trip somebody else up. And Jesus says, man, whoa, you better watch yourself with that, because you don't want to live that way. So we've got to watch what we do in our lives so that we don't offend, so that we aren't offended, because when it comes, we're prepared for it. Maybe you've already been offended. Maybe you said, man, I wasn't prepared for what happened to me. And that's okay. We'll talk about that, because offense leads to bitterness, and we'll talk about what bitterness does to us. But there's some things that we can discuss, and there's some things that we can understand about offense. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Galatians. Book of Galatians. There's Paul the Apostle really writes this neat section of scripture for us. So we understand that offenses are going to come our way. I know that nobody wants to hear that, but we also need to understand that we got to watch what we do, what we say, how we act, how we present ourselves, that we might not ruin the witness of Jesus Christ in our lives or offend somebody else and cause them to stumble, because that's on us when it comes to God. And so how we do this, how we get beyond this, is not by our own power. Hey, listen, you can't do it. You can't self-better yourself to not being an offensive person. You can't work hard at preparing yourself for offense when it comes, because it's natural tendency for us. So what we have to learn how to do is not live according to what we know in the flesh, but live according to the Spirit of God, because through the Holy Spirit, through the Spirit of God, He has given to us through His grace something that helps us deal with offense. It's called the fruits of the Spirit. So here in Galatians in the 5th chapter, verse number 19, Paul says, now the works of the flesh are evident. I like this. They're easy. We don't have to practice them. We don't have to work at developing these in our lives. They just kind of happen. The works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication. How about this? Uncleanliness. That's pretty offensive sometimes. Lewdness. Super offensive. Idolatry, sorcery, hatred, offended. Contentions, offended. Jealousies, offended. Outbursts of wrath, offensive. Selfish ambitions, offensive. Dissensions, offensive. Heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like. You see, human nature is offensive. It's easy. We don't have to try to be offensive. All we got to do is just live, and we'll be offensive and be offended. But you see, when we find Jesus, when we come to know Jesus as our Lord and Savior, like we sang that song, when you don't know what else to say, say the name, we stop living according to the principles of the flesh, and we start living according to what God has given us, His Holy Spirit. So He says, I've told you that those who practice these things will not inherit the kingdom of God. So then He goes on to verse number 22, and He says, but the fruit of the Spirit, the evidence of living in the Spirit of God, the evidence of operating with God on the inside of you, is this: love, joy, peace, long-suffering. Man, we need that when it comes to offense. Kindness, need that. Goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such, there is no law. Did you notice that these fruits are all external actions on the outward to somebody else? To love somebody else. To have joy with somebody else. Go back to verse number 22 for me. To have peace. To have long suffering with someone. To be kind. To be good. To be faithful. These are outward appearances. These are interactions with your fellow human beings. So you see, we can live a life that doesn't offend. Now, hey, listen, some might be offended because of the gospel, and there's nothing that you can do about that. But heaven forbid we offend because of our selfish ambitions, because of our contentions, because of our pain, because we ought to live in the fruits of the Spirit. Verse number 24 comes on, so just skip through it to verse number 24 for me, guys. And those who are Christ have crucified the flesh. We don't live that way any longer with its passions and desires. Verse number 25. If we live in the Spirit, let us walk in the Spirit. When it comes to the tripping point, the tripping hazard of offense, church, we've got to learn to walk in the Spirit. That's how we overcome offenses. It's not a personal self-betterment thing. We won't get any better We're still humans, but through the power of God, through the Holy Spirit in operation in us, we can go beyond offenses. You know, there's some very important things that we've also got to understand, that we have to watch where we're at, who we hang out. Watch your influences in life. Have you ever heard that phrase, birds of a feather flock together? You are or you become what you spend time with or what you hang around. Watch your influences in your life. I remember there was a time when I would drive home and I would listen to talk radio. You know, it was always just so intriguing. You know, I'd always wanted to know what's going on and to watch the news and to watch, you know, everything that's going on. And I had to come to a point where I just had to make a decision to stop listening, to stop sowing these things into my life. Why? Because I realized that I was starting to talk like the radio hosts. And some of you chuckle because, you know, man, on talk radio, they're always mad. They're always offended or they're always offending somebody. Why? Because that's what gets you to listen to somebody talking for 3 hours. They got to keep you on. And I had to make a decision. I couldn't watch the news anymore. My wife and I, we don't watch the news. Dr. Kobernick and Linda asked us about a big hot topic. And I was like, I don't even know, man. I don't watch the news anymore. I don't listen to the talk radio. I had to separate myself from that. Why? Because I was pouring it into my soul. And the influences of my life, I was becoming like that. I was getting frustrated. I was saying stupid things that they were saying on the radio. And I remember, we have to watch what we allow to influence our lives. The book of Romans says this. It says, I urge you, brethren, note those who cause division and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learned, and avoid them. If you're walking around people that are complaining all day, if you're spending time with people that all they have is something negative to say, something offensive, or all they're doing is talking about how offended they were or are, it's only a matter of time before that rubs off on you and you become that way. And Paul warns the church. He says, listen, point out, figure out who those are in your life and avoid them. Don't spend time with them. Don't wrap yourselves up in their words, because eventually their words, their thoughts will become your words, your thoughts. And you'll be easily offended because they were easily offended. You'll be offensive to those who are around you because they were offensive in what they said. Church, let us carry the witness of the gospel of Jesus Christ with a life that reflects his goodness, with the spirit of the Holy Spirit, with the fruits of the Holy Spirit of love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, gentleness, kindness, perseverance to our brothers and sisters, because that's the life that God has called us to live, not a life tripped up on our face because we're offended by what somebody's done. Yes, I've been offended. You've been offended. And I imagine some of you in this place have been so hurt that words don't even describe. And you say, man, I don't even know the half of how to get beyond that. And that's why I say I love that song, because the only way for you to get over that tripping, to get off that rock that you're stuck on, is the name of Jesus. Like my truck, I had a jack that could lift me up over that rock. Jesus Christ will lift you up off the dirt and the muck and the mire of your offense and your past and get you beyond. Because God doesn't want us to be tripped up. Sometimes what happens is we begin to harbor offenses. Offenses come in our lives and they begin to stew in us. And that brings about that second thing that gets us stuck in life: bitterness. Oh, bitterness, the root of destruction. When we moved into our house a couple of years ago, our neighbors had these trees, these poplar trees. We have poplars. As you drive in on the main campus, on the main entrance of the church, you see these big green trees in front of the office. You guys know what I'm talking about? Big, tall, green trees. Those are poplar trees. We liked them so much, we went to the nursery here in Redlands, and we asked the guy that runs the nursery. He says, man, we want to buy some poplar trees and put in our yard. And the guy said, no, you don't. We said, no, our neighbors have them. They grow fast. We like that. We want shade. And he says, I don't sell poplars. He says, as a matter of fact, some people even consider poplar to be a weed. And we were talking to our neighbors, and they says, yeah, man, when we planted these trees 7 years ago, they were little trees, little saplings. And in the course of 7 years, they grew to 24-inch trunks, 40 to 50 feet high. It was really cool because when you live in a new development, everybody has trees with sticks on each side. You know what I'm talking about? You drive through, there's no shade. Everybody's got sticks on their trees. I hate that. So it was like so cool. Like we had mature trees. And because we live close together in our association, it was like they were our trees. We loved their trees. One day they came over and they told us, they said, hey, for a couple of days you're gonna see a tree crew. And we're cutting our trees down. And we were like, no! You can't cut your trees down. Those are like the best part of our neighborhood. Everybody likes to sit in the shade of the tree. And they're like, no, we have to cut them down because the tree is lifting up our driveway and it's cracking our driveway. You see, that tree was a seed, something small, insignificant, a little sapling. And what happened is over the course of time, that little seed grew. And as that seed grew, the tree got bigger and bigger and bigger until finally the tree made itself, the roots of that tree made itself to the driveway. And then it began to grow under the driveway. And the force of the tree lifted up thousands and thousands and thousands of pounds of concrete. And they had to cut the tree down. Bitterness is exactly like that for you and I. A little seed, a little offense. Somebody said something, they did something, and we like to hold on to it. Bitterness starts out small. And so we hold on to it as humans. Our nature is to stew over things. Man, I'm going to hold on to that. I won't forget. And we say that we'll hold on to it so that we don't let it happen to us again. And so what we do is we rehearse it. We think about it. We hold it. We carry it with us wherever we go. And it starts out small. And like that poplar tree, we don't even know what's going on the inside. The book of Proverbs tells us that the heart knows its own bitterness. A stranger doesn't share in its joy. You see, on the inside of you, bitterness starts on the inside. You may not even see the effects of it. May not even realize that it's doing something. But on the inside, a destructive force is growing every moment you hold on to it. Every moment you feed it. Every moment you water it, it grows and it grows and it grows and it grows. Until finally there will be a point in your life where it begins to show its destructive force. So they cut that tree down. And we were so heartbroken by that, and we were so bummed, but something began to happen, and I'll tell you about it in just a moment, but bitterness begins in the heart. It starts out small. So in order to deal with bitterness in your heart, we have to realize something, that the root must be removed. The root must be removed. Because you see, it's the destructive force that we don't see, that they didn't see in the ground. It was the destructive forces of that root that was causing the damage, not the tree in the shade of the tree. But that root had grown and it got to our yard. It started going underneath our driveway. And I was out there. I didn't have any gardening tools and I had woodworking tools. So I had a chisel and a hammer. And I'm hammering this root, trying to pull it out of my driveway because it was starting to come up underneath my driveway. And we were tripping on it. And it was really frustrating. So we realized that the root must be removed. It must be cut out. We've got to get rid of the root of bitterness, whatever it is that you're holding on to. Ephesians in the third chapter, in the middle of Paul's prayer, he says something about you and I. He's talking about this. This is his prayer for us as church, that we might understand the mystery of God and have a reverence and a respect and an awe for what God has for us. But he says these words about us. He says that in Christ may dwell and that in our Christ might dwell in our hearts through faith, that you and I would be rooted and grounded in love. But you see, if we're not rooted in love, then we're rooted in something else. Because ultimately in your life, you're going to set down roots somewhere. A foundation that you build upon every day. Every experience, every decision, every action is the recourse of something that has happened previous to you. And so if you're not rooted and grounded in love through Jesus Christ, then you're going to be rooted and grounded in something else. And likely what it's going to be is what's happened to you in your life, your experience, which leads to a root and a foundation of bitterness. So we've got to learn to cut the roots, to get rid of them, to cut it out. The root of your heart cannot be bitterness. It must be love. In the book of Psalms, The psalmist says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. You see, in order for you to cut out the root, it's not like you can go in and do the surgery on yourself. Once again, this cannot be a self-help message. Oh man, that's some good words. Praise God, we shouldn't get caught up with offense and we shouldn't get caught up with bitterness, because ultimately, with our own human ability, we can't get beyond it. But through Jesus Christ, through God, he can come and do some gardening. He can come and do some tending. Hey, you know what? He can come and do some serious landscaping in our lives. The root has got to be removed. I see my friend Federico, I was a little bit hard on him on Friday because Pastor Jim walked around the campus and there was a tree. Maybe you noticed it when you were walking in. There used to be a tree. And there was a tree and the root was coming out of the ground and it was a tripping hazard. And so Dad told Federico, this is not a suggestion, cut that root out. Well, that was a big root. As a matter of fact, the root was probably like 10 inches. It was huge. So what happens is Federico says, yeah, okay, you know, you're the boss. I cut the root. So he cuts the root and his guys come and they dig up the roots and they cut them out. And sure enough, the first puff of wind on Friday night, right before our young adult service, somebody comes walking in. They're like, Pastor Luke, there's a tree laying in the fountain. The very first puff of wind, that tree blew over. I got a little picture of it, just so you could see. That was Friday at 6:58 in the, probably like 6:30 in the afternoon, that tree fell over. But you see, you could cut that tree down, but the root would have still been in the ground. It wasn't until they cut that root that that tree lost its hold. If you cut the tree down, hey, you know what? Cool, man. On the outside, it's all good between us. You know what? For the sake of posterity, we'll be cool around everybody. But if the roots still exist, the tripping hazard still is there. But when you cut the root, the tree has nothing left to be founded in, and it's only a matter of time before the outward appearance follows what's going on the inside. And so that root has got to be removed. It's got to be cut out. Cut that root out. And the only way you and I can cut that root out is Jesus. It's through the grace of the Holy Spirit. You think about it like this. We just talked about the fruits of the Spirit. That's how we cut the root out. Because I tell you what, there are some deep pains in this building. There are some deep wounds of bitterness. I know. I mean, in our young adults group, just last week, we had this thing where everybody just wanted, we told them, we said, what season are you in? Just by a key word, whether it's a winter, summer, fall, or spring, good or bad, what kind of season are you in? We got 60-something cards back. Out of the 60-something cards, only 8 were good. There's a lot of pain in humanity. You've got a lot of things that have happened to you. A lot of wounds on the inside. And you know what? You might have addressed the issue on the surface level by cutting the tree down, but the root still exists. Until you come to the realization that through Jesus Christ, through God, like the psalmist says, God can create a new heart on the inside of you, that you would no longer be rooted and founded in bitterness and what happened to you, but that you would learn to let it go and to forgive, then all of a sudden something begins to happen. Why? Because forgiveness is like poison to bitterness. Forgiveness is like poison to bitterness. Now, I told you about my neighbors. They cut the tree down, but they didn't deal with the roots. We didn't know the extent of those poplar roots until they cut that tree down. Because you see, the life support system of that tree, up until the time they cut it down, everything was focused on making that tree grow up. But the moment they cut that tree down, something interesting happened all over our yard, all over their yard, all over our backyard, everywhere else. Sprouts began to come out of the lawn. Everywhere. Every day, a new little sprout would come out. Up against our foundation of our house, in our garden bed, in the middle of our lawn, we'd pull it out. The next day, somewhere else, another sprout, and another sprout, and another sprout. Literally, hundreds of little tiny sprouts popped up, and we were out there scratching our heads, and they're like, you know, they're coming out there, and they're like, man, we're so sorry. We really didn't mean to like ruin your grass. And what they had to do is they had to bring somebody out to poison the root. Because even though the tree was gone, underneath the root was still growing. And now that its effort wasn't focused on building the tree up, the roots were growing out and they were trying to start new trees. And if we don't cut the root off, if we don't kill the root of bitterness in our lives, there will be a time, man, everything's okay, I'm great, I'm good. But then something will pop up. A seed of the enemy will come to you. A memory. Somebody will say something or remind you of what you used to be bitter about. And guess what will happen? That root's still alive on the inside. You didn't know it was there. And a sprout comes up. And then a sprout comes up. And a sprout comes up. And a sprout comes up. So what we've got to learn to do in our own lives is to poison the root of bitterness on the inside. And forgiveness is like that poison. Literally, drowning it out with what God has for each and every one of us. You're there in the book of Galatians. Just turn with me a couple pages over to the book of Colossians. While you turn to Colossians, I'll just tell you that Paul says this. I'll put it up on the overhead in Ephesians. He says, let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you. Cut it out. Get rid of it. Feed yourself. Feed yourself on the word of Jesus. Feed and poison your bitterness with the love of Jesus Christ. I mean, who would have thought that? Like, you know, you almost say it like this, like, Jesus' words are poison. Like, you never hear somebody say that from the pulpit, right? Like, the Bible is poison to bitterness. The words of God are death to bitterness and offense in your life when you apply them. You see, you fed your life. You fed your bitterness all your life, and it grew. Now you're going to have to start by feeding your bitterness forgiveness and watch it die. Start feeding your bitterness forgiveness and watch it die. They poisoned that root, and the next week, one or two sprouts came up. Okay, cool. A week after that, one sprout came up. Month after that, nothing happened again. Why? Because they began to feed that root systematically poison that killed it. You begin to feed the root of bitterness on the inside of your life systematically the word of God through Jesus Christ by living and operating in the Spirit and the fruits of the Spirit, and you will begin to see the bitterness in your life die. I told you to turn over to Colossians. Look what it says in the book of Colossians. Bear with one another. Forgive one another. Man. Sometimes what's happened to us can only be done, can only be let go. We can only learn to forgive through the power of Christ on the inside of us. If anyone has a complaint against one another, even as Christ forgave you, so you must do. You see, we were an offense to God. We lived offensive lives to God. But even that, the book of Romans tells us that because of our offenses, Jesus Christ died. And because of the example of God set before us, that he could get over the offense of humanity through sin, that means that we are capable through God of getting over the offenses and the bitterness that have happened to us through Christ. So that we can feed our bitterness, forgiveness, and to watch it die. And he goes on in verse number 14. Verse number 14, he says, but above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which you were called to one body, and be thankful. Listen to this. Let the word of Christ dwell in you, richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. He says, let the words of Christ dwell in you. Let the words of Christ dwell in you. The poison for the bitterness and the experience that you hold on to that sometimes makes us get up in the morning is the words of Christ. That we could get beyond that. That we could say, you know what? I will go beyond the surface level. I'm not just going to cut the tree down so that we could be good on the outside. But I'm going to let it go on the inside by poisoning it with love. You remember, it's still kind of going on. But you remember a couple of months ago, there was that big measles scare. You know what I'm talking about? You guys remember that? Like where somebody got it at Disneyland and somebody got it here. I think Trader Joe's, somebody got it in Redlands. And everybody was freaked out about measles. Well, we had like an event that we were supposed to go to, like a birthday party. And my wife and I, we were at our service, at our young adult service. And my mother-in-law, or her mom, was watching the kids and she just brought the kids. My daughter, Emma, had little red bumps everywhere. Like any rational parent did, that when their daughter wakes up and it's all over, everybody's talking about measles, and we had just gone to Disneyland, we freaked out. So we went to the doctor, and we called our friend Dr. Kanga as well. Both the doctor and Dr. Kanga said, it's not measles, it's an allergic reaction. So we gave her a little bit of like hydrocortisone or whatever it is that you rub on them, and okay, cool, you know, no big deal. Well, when we took her to my mother-in-law took her to the party, some of the people there, the family members, people that are close to us, were so mad that we brought our daughter, who they swore up and down had the measles. And we called them, hey, she doesn't have the measles. Two doctors looked at her. She doesn't have the measles. And a family blow-up happened over my little girl because she had little red dots on her arms and on her chest. And, you know, we got so mad at them because of the way they treated us and the way that they talked about our kids, family members. I was so bitter at this person. Somebody who was close to me, somebody that I've shared things with. I mean, somebody that I've spent a great deal of time with. I told my wife, I don't care if I ever talk to them again. Because you don't talk about my kids like what you said. And I began to stew on it. I began to tell my family, well, I guess I realize what we really stand. Now I know how they see us and my little boogery children. And I was feeding myself this bitterness. And they would call us or they'd text. It was a couple events. Hey, we're going to have dinner. Come over and hang out with us. And it's like, no, I got things to do. I'm sorry, I can't go. And I would use work or I would use life as an excuse to say, I can't be around you. But on the inside, I knew that there's this root of darkness growing in my heart of bitterness because they hurt my feelings, because they offended me. And because I did what most humans do, I held on to it. I grabbed onto it and I began to feed it. Can't believe that they would do that. I began to feed it. Well, I guess I know how I guess we aren't really friends like we thought we were. I guess I'm just, you know, the in-law or whatever it was. But it wasn't until finally I looked at my own heart and I looked at my own life and I said, God, this is so trivial. It's so elementary. It's so junior high. For me to get so tripped up over a relationship as important as this relationship is to me, to stop that because of their offensive words to me. And I had already let it, they didn't even know we were offended. They didn't even care that we were offended. But it wasn't until I finally said, you know what, I'm going to pour forgiveness into this. I'm going to speak what Jesus says over this. I believe that my life will be a testimony to them someday. And I won't let this moment be a pivotal part of my life and my relationship. And I begin to speak and think in my life and in my heart what the Word of God says. To not be so easily offended. To not jump off the deep end at somebody. But to be long-suffering. To be gentle. To be kind. To be hospitable. To not just show up and sit in the corner and be like, what's up? Yeah, cool. Hey, I saw you. I did my part. But to go out of my way to develop and to keep that relationship, to let them know, you know what? It's not just surface level, but the truth is I've let it go. And it wasn't until then that all of a sudden the things that were going on in my life began to clear up. Why? Because that bitterness was like a root that was lifting up the driveway or the foundation of my life, and it was affecting all other areas of my life. But when I began to poison my bitterness with the Word of God, it began to retreat. And when it did, I'll tell you what, I really began to see the working of God in my life. And I tell you, it's just so not worth it, church, for us to get stuck over what's happened to us in the past. I mean, imagine what would Christianity be like if God was stuck over what we did to him in the past. But yet he gave the example for us to get beyond that, to not be offended by what we've done to him, but because of that, to lay his life down in forgiveness and restoration. Through the power of Jesus Christ in your life, you don't have to be so easily offended. When somebody says something to you, you can be prepared to say, you know what? They're going to say something, but like water off a duck's back, I'm going to let it go. Because the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, meekness, gentleness, kindness, perseverance, I'm going to press on. I won't let this stop me in life. I won't let the root of bitterness keep me stuck any longer. But I'll give it to Christ. And through Jesus Christ and through his words, through his love, we'll begin to poison that root that has destroyed so much of my joy and my happiness. And I'll replace it with his love and his word. Today, before we leave, before we finish the message, there are some of you in this place that you've got bitterness and offense in your heart right now. You brought it in. You've been carrying it with you like a trash bag on your back. Something that's been going on. Something that somebody said to you. Something that somebody did to you. You were offended. You were hurt. And you're bitter. But let me tell you something. Today, you don't have to carry it out. You brought it here, but this is the best place to bring your offense and your bitterness, because you can leave it here today. So what I want to do in just a moment, I just want to pray. If that's you in this place today, and you've got bitterness in your heart, you say, man, I really, like what you're talking about is me. Like, I have been tripped up by bitterness. I have been tripped up because I was offended that somebody did something or didn't do something. They weren't there when they should have been. If that's you today, listen, there's no shame in it. If that's you in this place today, I just want to ask if you'd stand, because I want to pray with you. Wherever you're at in this place, if that's you all over this place, hey, listen, there's no shame. Don't be embarrassed about it. We are human in this place. And you've been carrying that bitterness. You've been carrying that offense long enough. That drama, that weight. And it's time, like the book of Hebrews says, to let us set aside the weight of sin and the things that so easily ensnare us. Hey, I'll tell you what, bitterness and offense are easy traps for the devil to use. But we'll set those aside and we'll run the race, because ultimately life moves forward. And today, commit in your heart to move forward. To not just deal with it on the surface, but to deal with the root. Not on your own power or ability, but through the grace and the word and the love of Jesus Christ that operates through you. Begin to rely on that. So I'm going to pray with you. And if that's you this place, I just want you, while I'm praying, I want you to think about what that is, that hurt, that offense, and I want you to give it to God. The Bible says, cast your cares upon him who cares for you. When you cast something, think of it like this. You're throwing it like a baseball or a football. It's not a boomerang. It's not coming back. Let it go. No strings attached. Give it to God today and commit to feeding your spirit the love, the words, the example of Jesus Christ, and watch it begin to die. Let's pray together. Father, I just lift up the saints of God in this house. Lord, all across this place, Lord, the people that are here, the people that are at home right now, dealing with bitterness in their hearts, dealing with offense. Lord, somebody said something, somebody did something, somebody neglected to do something that was painful. And Lord, we've held on to it long enough. Lord, your desire for us, your people, is to not be tripped up, to not be stuck, to not live a life of Christianity crawling on our hands and our knees, but to stand with our heads held high and our shoulders back and our chin up, because Jesus said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Lord, you did not design humanity to carry the burdens that we carry today. And Lord, tonight, let this be a night. Your Holy Spirit is here, moving and operating in this house, working in the lives of each and every person that's in here tonight, saying, this is no longer your weight. This is no longer your burden. That root will no longer destroy, but now I will poison. I will drown it out. I will cut it out. I will remove it, and I will replace it with the love of God, that we would be rooted in Jesus and not in bitterness. That we would be rooted in the past experience of what God has done for us and not in the past experience of what man has done to us. So, Father, today we give this to you. We cast it. We throw it out there. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would speak to each and every person. Lord, your word says in 2 Corinthians in the first chapter that you are a God of comfort. Lord, I pray that your comfort of the Holy Spirit would move upon us. Each and every person that's in this place reaching out to you today, Lord, that you would begin to comfort them, fill them the warmth like a sun, like the warmth of a sun on a warm day, filling them and warming them with the Holy Spirit, saying, no longer, child, do you have to carry this. No longer, child, do you have to lay on the ground tripped up. But through the Holy Spirit, Lord, we would move on. Lord, your word says that you are a comfort, that you would comfort us in our time of need, that someday we would give that comfort that we've received to somebody else. And Lord, I pray that each and every person that's in this place would be a walking and living testimony of the power of the Holy Spirit in operation in Christianity today. That then people would look at them and say, how have you moved on? And that they would be able to share your goodness, as your word of God says, as Jesus says, that we would shine for the world to see your glory. So Holy Spirit, do surgery on us today. Open us up. We invite you to open us, to remove the root of bitterness, to remove the seed of offense. Lord, we cast it to you. We give it to you today. Lord, we don't want it back. You take it. And fill with us, create in us a clean heart, oh God. Rebuild in us a steadfast love. Father, to you we give the praise and the glory and the honor for what you will and what you have begun to do in us right here, right now. Let this be a day, Lord, that we move forward for you on this April 19th, 2015, a day that we leave the destructive root. Lord, we leave the stumbling block of offense behind, and we get up. And we press forward in you, in Jesus' mighty name. We all said, amen. Amen. Praise God. Now you have a commitment. Those of you that stood up, those of you that are at home, you have a commitment, a responsibility. When that seed starts to pop itself up, hey, a sprout comes out of your lawn, you poison it with the love of God. You poison it with the word of God. You poison that bitterness with the fruits of the Spirit. And you watch what God does in your life. You can, you will be successful and blessed in this life here on earth, because that's a promise of Jesus Christ. And it starts by poisoning what trips you up. Listen, we're gonna end in just a couple of minutes, so I'm going to just reverse things in just a moment. If you're in this place and you don't know Jesus, if you're in this place today and you don't have that relationship with Christ, today, if that's you, I want to give you the opportunity in just a moment to get solidified in your life, to get rid of the old, to become a new creation, as the Bible says, through Jesus Christ. It starts by accepting Jesus as your Lord and as your Savior. You see, I'm not going to go through the whole ordeal. I'm not going to go through the whole process of what we normally do, because I've been praying for you all day. And the Bible says that it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. And if you're in this place right now and you can feel the drawing of the Holy Spirit, if you can feel the tugging of your heartstrings that God is calling you home, maybe you've been playing God, you've been playing games with God, been thinking that everything's okay because you attend church, been thinking that everything's okay because you've given yourself a title, you've been living lukewarm, doing some of your own thing to some of God's thing. Listen, if that's you and you've been feeling that tug of the Holy Spirit on you today, in a moment, I'm going to give you that opportunity. Jesus said these words. He says, if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. He says, if you deny him, he will deny you. The decision is yours. God's not a manipulator. He's not going to connive or force or make his way in. Listen, he's calling you home, but it's your choice to respond to Jesus Christ today. The only way you can ensure a life of abundance, a life of blessing and fulfillment with the inside out is through Jesus Christ. He's the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except through him. So if that's you in this place, I'm going to ask you to do something. The Spirit of God's talking to you right now, and you say, man, I know it's me. It's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. Maybe you've never given your heart to Jesus Christ. Maybe you did this as a child, or you've been, you went to a harvest crusade, or you did this back in the day, you prayed that prayer, but you've never really followed through. You never really carried on with that. Maybe you've been living a lukewarm life. What does that mean? You've got your ups and your downs and your ins and your outs. If that's you, just a moment, I'm going to give you the opportunity to accept Jesus into your heart, to change your life forever. But it starts by making an action to follow after, to accept the gift of God. And if that's you in this place today, we're going to do something. I'm going to ask everybody to stand in the house today. Every person in this place, if that's you in this place, as everybody stands, if you know who you are, you can feel the Spirit of God calling you, bringing you in. This is your moment. This is your time. He says, confess him before men, and he'll confess you before his Father. I want you to do something. I want to change destinies with you. I want to pray with you tonight, right here, right now. But it starts by you making that decision. And I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to get out of your chair, get out of your seat, get into the aisle, and come meet me right here. And let's change destinies together. Elijah's going to sing a song. And if that's you, you know who you are in this place today. Come on. Let's quit messing around. Let's quit living a life of being stumbled and stuck. And let's go forward with Jesus today. It starts by making that decision. So Elijah's going to sing a song. If that's you, you know who you are in this place. The Spirit of God's speaking to you. Get out of your seat. Get out of your chair. Come. Let's change destinies together right here, right now. Come on. If that's you, you come.
Jesus, I believe in you. Jesus, I belong.
You come.
You're
be that first one.
You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I breathe.
They're coming.
Jesus, I believe.
If that's you in this place today, you feel God telling you, pulling you, drawing you in. Stop
Jesus,
running. Start walking.
To you.
Wherever you're at in this place.
You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I breathe.
You can come. They're coming right now.
I believe. Jesus, I believe.
I can feel that there's more of you. I could just feel you in this place. You're afraid. Listen, guys, let's get over what we think other people will think about us. I'll stand up here and be a fool for you. Make myself a spectacle for you. Because it's so important that you listen to God speaking to you right now. It's the goodness of God, the Bible says, that draws men to repentance. And you can feel that in your life right now, on your heart. Elijah's going to sing that song. Nobody, we're not even going to clap. We're going to stay silent. But if that's you in this place today, hey, get over the outward appearance of what you think somebody might think. And go forward in what God has for you. Because I tell you what, your whole life is ahead of you. But it starts by giving it to Jesus Christ. And we're going to do that together right here, right now. Elijah, sing that song.
Jesus, I believe in you.
If that's you, you know who you are.
Jesus,
you come.
I belong.
Get out of your seat. Get out of your chair.
To you.
Come on up here. Let's change destinies together.
You're the reason that I live.
Coming.
You're the reason that I breathe.
If that's you in this place, you
Jesus,
know who you are.
I believe.
They're coming. This is your moment. This is your time.
To you. You're the reason that I live.
Yeah.
You're the reason that
This is for you. You come. You know who you are. You can feel it. Bible says no one comes to the Father unless the Holy Spirit draws him. Don't resist any longer.
Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live.
You can come. They're still coming. Elijah's going to keep singing.
Jesus,
one more time, Elijah.
Jesus, I believe.
Wherever you're at, you come.
In you. Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I breathe. Jesus, I believe.
Praise God. Hey, guys. So good. So good. Listen. Congratulations. You are making a huge and good decision. I want to share something cool with you. You've got heavy hearts, and that's good because the Spirit of God's on you, and that's good. It's drawing you in. But listen, you're not going to a funeral, all right? You're going to a birthday celebration. Today is the very first day of the rest of your lives. God's got some great things in store for you. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is going to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on. He's going to lead you into prayer. You're going to invite Jesus to come into your life, to be the Lord and Savior. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? We don't talk like that very often. The leader of your life. He'll give you some free literature, some free information just to help point you in the right direction. When you walk out of here, you say, what do I do? I want to help set you in the right direction. The last thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. We want you to hang out with us. We want to get you connected here with a friend. We'll pair you up with a friend, somebody that'll meet with you before church. They'll buy a cup of coffee or get you some french fries or something like that at the cafe. Meet with you for just a couple of weeks. You're not joining some big, long program. Just meet with somebody for a couple of weeks to teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.